Hi everyone, to be continued with another nursing lecture, I have a new topic, that is maternal pelvis, and in this session I will discuss about the bones, ligaments, joints, the difference between true and false pelvis, with the diameters and landmarks of an obstetrical importance, the types of pelvis and the parameters which are showing the relationship between the maternal pelvis and the fetal skull. So let's start with the bones, and here in this animation you can see the bony pelvis, and this bony pelvis forms a ring-like structure and it is bounded anteriorly by the symphysis pubis, a fibrocartilaginous joint. Laterally it is bounded by three fused bones. These are the hip bones, superiorly the ilium, inferiorly and posteriorly is the ischium, and anteriorly is the pubic bone. Posteriorly, these hip bone articulate with the sacrum. Here it is. So these three hip bones form a girdle of contact, that is pelvic girdle or hip girdle, which create a contact between axial skeletal system and appendicular skeletal system. And here you can see posteriorly it articulate with the sacrum, which is the part of vertebral column and axial skeletal system, and inferiorly it articulate with the lower limb, which is the part of appendicular system. So in maternal pelvis we'll discuss in detail about the two hip bones, and these are the three separate bone, ilium, ischium and pubis bone, and these fuse together, but here we'll discuss separately, and one sacrum and one coccyx. Here comes the ilium, and it is the largest part in the hip bone and it forms the superior region. In the ilium, the superior flared part is termed as ala, and the inferior part which connects with the ischium is the body. Then the superior border of the ilium is the iliac crest, and it ends anteriorly at a blunt end and is anterior superior iliac spine, and just below to that is anterior inferior iliac spine. Posteriorly, this iliac crest ends at a sharp end and it is the posterior superior iliac spine, and just below to that is posterior inferior iliac spine. Just below to the posterior inferior iliac spine there is a notch, and it is greater sciatic notch through which the largest nerve in your body, that is sciatic nerve, passes. And on the posterior aspect of the ilium is a roughened area which is termed as iliac tuberosity, and it gives attachment for the ligaments. And then on the medial aspect there is a fossa, and it is the iliac fossa, and it gives attachment for the various tendons of the muscle of trunk, hip as well as the thighs. Then there is a articulating area, and this articulating area articulate with the sacrum and forms the sacroiliac joint. From this articulating surface area there is a line which runs superiorly or anteriorly, is the arcuate line, and later on it has an important landmark in obstetrical point of view. The next bone comes the ischium, and it forms the inferior and the posterior region, and there is a prominent feature posteriorly is the ischial spine, and it gives attachment for the various tendon of the muscle. And there is the body or the roughened area which is termed as ischial tuberosity. It helps a person to sit. And anterior to the body is the ramus, and this ramus fuses with the pubic bone. The ramus of the ischium and the body of pubic bone forms a largest foramen in our body, that is obturator foramen, and is covered with the obturator membrane through which blood vessel as well as nerve passes. Then comes the another bone of hip is the pubic bone. And the pubic bone consisting of the superior ramus, the inferior ramus and the both ramus meet together at the body region. The anterior border of the body forms the pubic crest, and lateral to that is one projection is termed as pubic tubercle. It runs superiorly and laterally and merge with arcuate line to form iliopectineal line, and the inferior rami of the both pubic form the pubic arc over here, and there is a fibrocartilaginous disc in between the pubic bone which forms symphysis pubis. Together the pubic bone, ilium and ischium form a socket like structure where the head of the femur attaches with it and forms a ball and socket type of synovial joint which allows free movement like the flexion, extension, circumduction, rotation, adduction, abduction. So a person can easily walk, run or can move her limbs to any of the direction. This socket like structure is termed as acetabulum. There is an acetabular notch and it forms a foramen through which blood vessel as well as the nerve pass through it. Then the next bone in the bony pelvis is the sacrum, and it is a triangular shaped bone which is formed by a 5 fused vertebra, and it forms the part of axial skeletal system which connects laterally with the ilium and form the strongest joint in the body, that is sacroiliac joint. The broader superior portion is termed as the base, and the narrow inferior portion is termed as apex. In females, this bone is more shorter, wider and curved anteriorly. The superior portion of the sacrum is projected more anteriorly and is termed as sacral promontory. Laterally from the sacral promontory are the auricular shaped structure. These are termed as sacral ala or sacral wings, and at the end there is a auricular surface, here it is, where it articulate with the ilium and form sacroiliac joint. Posteriorly, the sacrum is more roughened and it gives attachment for the various muscles, and it is convex structure. There are the four transverse line, here it is, and these are indicating the fusion of vertebral bodies of the sacrum, and at the end of transverse line there are four pairs of anterior foramina, and these are continuous with the posterior foramina, and through which the blood vessels as well as the nerve passes. On the posterior medial aspect there is a sacral crest, and it is formed by the fusion of spinous process of sacral vertebras, and there is a sacral canal which is continuous with the vertebral cavity, and at the end it opens at the sacral hiatus, and on the either side of this hiatus are the sacral cornua, and these serves as the attachment point for the ligaments which connect with the coccyx. At the superior posterior end there are the articulating process, and these articulate with the lumbar vertebra and forms lumbosacral joint. At the inferior end of the sacrum is triangular shaped structure bone is the coccyx, which is formed by a 4 fused vertebra. In females it is directed inferiorly. At the posterior superior aspect there are the coccygeal cornua, and these serve as the attachment point for the ligaments which connect it with the sacrum. And in female the sacrococcygeal joint is more flexible, so at the time of delivery the baby can easily pass through this. So here we have seen the bones of maternal pelvis, and these are the paired hip bone consisting of the ilium, ischium and the pubic bone, and posteriorly one sacrum, and inferior to that is one coccyx. Then comes the joints and ligaments. The joints are the articulation between the two bones, and here it is one symphysis pubis, and it articulate the two pubic bone to each other. Then comes a paired sacroiliac joint, and it articulate the sacrum with the ilium, and this is the strongest joint in the body as it articulate the axial skeletal system with the pelvic girdle. Next comes the sacrococcygeal joint as it articulates the apex of the sacrum to the base of the coccyx. Then are the ligaments, and these are the structure which held together a pelvic joint, and in that there is interpubic ligament, or you can say symphysis pubis, and is united by a fibrocartilage. Then comes a sacroiliac ligament, here you can see, and there are the many, the left and right side. So in this you can see this is the left anterior sacroiliac ligament, and this one is the right sacroiliac ligament. And on the posterior aspect, there is right posterior interosseous sacroiliac ligament and the left posterior interosseous sacroiliac ligament. And below to that, which held the pelvic joint posteriorly, are the short posterior sacroiliac ligament, right as well as the left side. And next to this is the long right posterior sacroiliac ligament as well as the left one. Then there are superficial right and left posterior sacrococcygeal ligament, and there is deep posterior sacrococcygeal ligament, right as well as left side. And here is the sacrotuberous ligament, and it is present in between the sacrum and the ischial tuberosity, and it is also left as well as right one. On the anterior aspect, there is a right as well as left sacrococcygeal ligament, and it attaches sacrum to the coccyx anteriorly. Then there is left as well as the right sacrospinous ligament, and it attaches sacrum to the ischial spine. So here you have seen the joints and ligament, and during non-pregnant state there is very little movement in between the joint, but during pregnancy there is a hormonal effect, and it causes the ligament to be softened, thus increases the pelvic diameter so that it can easily accommodate the fetal head and it can easily passes through the bony pelvis. Next I deal about the difference between false and true pelvis, and the diameters and landmarks of maternal pelvis. In false pelvis, there is no exact pelvic measurement, but it supports the enlarged uterus at the time of pregnancy, and it is bounded posteriorly by the lumbar vertebra, laterally by the iliac fossa and the iliac crest, and these are the parts of hip bone, and anteriorly by the anterior abdominal wall. So in this figure, you can see the shaded region. This is the false pelvis. The true pelvis has got obstetrical importance as it has exact pelvic measurement, and anteriorly its wall is formed by symphysis pubis and is measuring about 4 cm. Posteriorly there is a deep wall and is formed by sacrum and coccyx and measuring about 12 cm long. So thus it forms a curved canal, and it is divided into 3 parts, and these are the pelvic brim or the inlet, and inner to that is the cavity, and the outer one is the pelvic outlet. So it provides a smooth canal through which fetus can easily pass, and the first part is the pelvic brim or the inlet, and here in this figure you can see the shaded region, and this forms the round circumference, and on that there are the various bony fixed points. These are termed as landmarks through which the fetus can easily come in contact with the maternal pelvis at the time of engagement. And here I have shown in a numerical sequence from 1 to 9 in an anterior to posterior way. These are symphysis pubis, pubic crest, pubic tubercle, pectineal line, iliopectineal eminence, iliopectineal line, sacroiliac joint, the anterior border of the ala of sacrum, and the sacral promontory. So these are the 9 landmarks. Now we'll see the diameters of the pelvic brim. There are 3 diameters: anterior posterior, the oblique, and the transverse diameter. In the anterior posterior, there are again 3, and these are the true conjugate, the obstetric conjugate, and the diagonal conjugate. The anatomical or true conjugate is the distance between the midpoint of the sacral promontory to the inner margin of the upper border of symphysis pubis, and it measures about 11 cm. Then comes the obstetric conjugate, and it is the exact space for the fetus so that it can easily pass through it, and its distance between the midpoint of sacral promontory to the projection in the midline on the inner surface of symphysis pubis and is measured about 10 cm. And the diagonal conjugate has a practical significance as we can measure it through the bimanual vaginal examination, and it is the distance between the lower border of symphysis pubis to the midpoint of sacral promontory, and it measures about 12 cm. So these are the three: anterior posterior diameter, the true conjugate, the obstetric conjugate, and the diagonal conjugate. Now in this figure you can see the transverse diameter, and it is the distance between the two farthest point on the pelvic brim over the iliopectinal line, and it measures about 13 cm. Then next comes the oblique diameter, and these are two, right and left one. Each one extends from one sacroiliac joint to the opposite iliopectinal eminence, and it measures about 12 cm. The right and left one denotes the sacroiliac joint from where it is started. Now we'll see the cavity. It forms the curved canal and is round in structure. It is bounded above by the inlet and below by the obstetrical outlet, and its anterior posterior diameter measures from the midpoint of posterior surface of symphysis pubis to the junction of second or third sacral vertebra, and it measures about 12 cm. The transverse and the oblique diameter can't be measured easily in this, as the point overlies the soft tissues. So roughly we can say the overall diameter of the cavity is 12 cm. The last part comes the outlet, and after this bony region the fetus can easily come out to the outer world, and this outlet has again two parts, the obstetrical outlet and the anatomical outlet. So here in the yellow shaded region I have shown the obstetrical outlet, and it is diamond shaped structure, and its anterior posterior diameter extend from the inferior border of symphysis pubis to the tip of the sacrum, and it measures about 11 cm. Its transverse diameter is the bispinous diameter, and it is the distance between the tip of the two ischial spine, and it measures about 10.5 cm. Now in the pink shaded region we have anatomical outlet, and its anterior posterior diameter extends from the lower border of symphysis pubis to the tip of the coccyx, and it measures about 13 cm. The transverse diameter or the intertuberous diameter of the pelvic outlet is the distance between the inner border of the ischial tuberosity, and it measures about 11 cm. So the obstetrical outlet has a practical value as the fetus has to pass through this outlet only. The oblique diameter of outlet can't be measured precisely as the point overlies the soft tissues. So roughly we can say it is about 12 cm. Next I deal about the types of pelvis, and on the basis of the shape of pelvic inlet or the brim, it is of four type: gynecoid, android, anthropoid, and the platypeloid. It is considered that the gynecoid is more ideal one as it accommodates the fetal skull which can easily pass through it. Its brim is rounded structure, and its sacrum is more shorter, wider, and curved anteriorly. Its ischial spines are blunt and their walls are straight. It forms 90 degree angle of subpubic arc. Next comes the android type, and it is similar to the male pelvis. Its brim is heart shaped structure, and its sacrum is short and straight. Their walls are converging inside and forms funnel shaped cavity. Their ischial spines are more prominent in comparison to the rest of three, and it forms less than 90 degree of subpubic arc. In the anthropoid type, the brim is large oval shaped structure and its anterior posterior diameter is larger in comparison to the transverse diameter. Their ischial spines are also blunt and its sacrum is more longer and curved anteriorly. Their walls are diverging outside and it forms more than 90 degree angle of subpubic arc. And the last comes the platypaloid type, and its brim is kidney shaped structure and its sacrum is more shorter and flat. Its transverse diameter is larger in comparison to the anterior posterior diameter, and their ischial spines are also blunt. It forms more than 90 degree of subpubic arc and their walls are also diverging outside. So here we have seen the four types of pelvis: the gynecoid, android, anthropoid and the platypaloid. Next, I will be discuss about the various parameters which are showing the relationship between the mother and the fetus. And in this, I am going to discuss about the lie, presentation, presenting part, attitude, denominator and the position. So first we'll see the lie. The lie means the relationship between the long axis of the fetus with the long axis of centralized uterus. Here you can see in this figure there are the three lies. These are longitudinal lie, oblique lie and the transverse lie. And out of three, the commonest lie is the longitudinal, in which whether the cephalic, it means the fetal skull, can come first, or the podalic region, it means the buttocks, can come first. Next comes the presentation, and it means the part of the fetus which occupies the lower pole of the uterus, and it consisting of the cephalic presentation, the podalic presentation, the shoulder presentation and the compound presentation. And here in this first figure you can see the cephalic presentation is showing over here, in which fetal skull occupies the lower pole of the uterus. And the podalic means when the buttocks can occupies the lower pole of the uterus. And in compound presentation, there are two or more regions of the fetus which overlies the internal os. The next comes presenting part, and it defined as the part of presentation which overlies the internal os. And in this figure you can see in cephalic presentation there are the three presenting part. The first figure showing the vertex presenting part, and in the second is the bro presenting part, and then third one showing is the face presenting part. So it completely depends on the degree of flexion. The first figure presenting the complete flexion, so the vertex presenting part is forming. The second figure shows the slight flexion, so it present the bro. And in third, there is a deflection of the head, thus the face presenting part is forming. The next parameter is the attitude, and it means the relationship of body part of the fetus to each other. And in first figure you can see that is the complete flexion of the fetus which occupies the ovoid of the uterus, in which the chin touches the chest and the upper limbs are folded together and the lower limbs fold toward the abdomen. The next is the denominator, and it is the bony fixed point on the presenting part. And in this figure you can see this is the occiput, which is the bony fixed point on the vertex presenting part. The last comes the position, and it is the relation of the denominator with the different quadrant of female pelvis. Here the denominator is the occiput, and it forms 8th position on the female pelvis. When the occiput lies anteriorly just behind the symphysis pubis, then it's termed as OA, occipito anterior. And when it lies posteriorly in front of the sacral promontory, then it termed as OP, occipito posterior. When the occiput lies anteriorly on the left side at iliopectinal eminence, then it's termed as LOA, and when it lies on right side, then it's termed ROA, right occipital anterior. When it lies on the iliopectinal line on left side, is termed as LOT, and when it lies on right side, then it's termed ROT, right occipital transverse. When occiput lies on the posterior aspect, just anterior to the sacroiliac joint, then it's termed left occipital posterior, and when it lies on the right side, then it's termed right occipital posterior. So out of them, the commonest position at the time of delivery is LOA, left occipital anterior, and sometime it is ROA, that is right occipital anterior. So in this lecture, we have seen how maternal pelvis create a bridge between axial skeletal with the appendicular skeletal system and how its diameters are adapted for childbirth. So thank you for watching this video. You can subscribe our channel and visit to our site.